What's poppin', YouTube? I know it's been a really long time since I did videos in this format, and I'm not trying to come back to it, but this kind of format, it's really easy to pop out a video really quickly, get my thoughts out, and move along so that I can focus my attention on things that matter. But this thing has been bugging me for quite some time, and I think I should get this out now, even though I am working on something, I'm working on a series of videos that hopefully should come out by next month. Hopefully. But, you know, life intervenes. But anyways. But first, I want to read this quote. This is by Yaron Brook, who is the chairman of the board at the Ayn Rand Institute. And it sounds really bad. Let's just get right into it. All value is created by physical labor, by physical work. That everything around us involves changing reality through physical work and the essential of taking something that's valueless, I don't know, a plot of land somewhere where shrubs are growing, and turning it into a thriving patch where you're growing vegetables for sale and market. The essential thing that makes one valuable is the physical labor that goes into it. So this is a real quote from Yaron Brook. He really did say this. But if you think that this is out of character for him, then you would be 100% right. This quote was cherry-picked, and it was cherry-picked in a very dishonest way. You see, I found this video of Yaron Brook rebutting the labor theory of value. I took the part where he explains what the labor theory of value is and omitted the part where he explains why people believed it and why it is false. I'll leave a link below in the description so you can watch the whole thing if you want. Now, this is no different than when I see this image circulating on the internet. It seems like Max Stirner is anti-property, doesn't it? Real big thunk here, right? If I was a complete idiot, then I would take this on face value and not investigate any further and maybe say something along the lines of, I don't know how you can interpret this any other way. But what if it wasn't? So let's take a look where in the book he said this, which is from The Ego and His Own. And I'll bring up both popular translations so you can see them on the screen. But the one I'm going to read from is Wolfi Landstreicher's because I think his translation is a lot more fitting. Proudhon, also Wheatling, believes that he is saying the worst about property when he calls it theft, completely leaving aside the embarrassing question of what well-founded objection one could make against theft. We only ask, is the concept of theft at all possible unless one lets the concept of property count? How can one steal if property doesn't yet exist? What belongs to no one cannot be stolen. You don't steal the water that you draw from the sea. Consequently, property is not theft, but a theft becomes possible only through property. Wheatling also has to come to this, since he indeed regards everything as the property of all. If something is the property of all, then indeed the individual who appropriates it to himself steals. Private property lives only by the grace of the law. Only in law does it have its guarantee. Indeed, possession is not yet property. It is only mine by the consent of the law. It isn't a fact, un fiat, as Proudhon says, but a fiction, a thought. This is legal property, legitimate property, guaranteed property. It is mine not by me, but by law. Still, property is the expression for the unlimited control over something, a thing, animal, human being, of which I can dispose of as I see fit. According to the Roman law, indeed, Roman Latin words I can't say, an exclusive and unlimited right. But property is brought about by power. What I have in my power, that is my own. As long as I assert myself as holder, I am the property owner of the thing. If it gets away from me again, no matter by what power, for example, through my recognition of another's entitlement to the thing, then the property is extinguished. So property and possession come together as one. No right lying outside my power legitimizes me, but only my power. If I no longer have this, then the thing disappears from me. When the Romans had no more power against the Germanic peoples, the Roman world empire belonged to the latter, and it would sound ridiculous for one to insist that the Romans still remain the real owners. to whoever knows how to take and hold the thing it belongs until someone takes it away from him, as freedom belongs to the one who takes it. So what did Stirner say? He said that this is the way Prideaux and Wheatling described property, as theft, only as something that exists through the grace of law and legal fiction. Stirner is saying that that is not just practically wrong, but it is wrong fundamentally, and that property comes through possession and defense of those attempting to take it. This is an attempt to paint Stirner as anti-property, and it is based on a cherry-picked quote. So you, dear reader, I offer this challenge, and I will give you another quote mine for you to dig out yourself. Find the original quote for this and see if it holds up to the people who attempt to use it to paint someone else with a position that they do not hold. All the great establishments of every kind, now in the hands of a few proprietors, but employing a great number of wage laborers, would be broken up for few or no persons who could hire capital and do business for themselves would consent to labor for wages for another. Lysander Spooner. Good luck. Happy hunting, worms.